Preservation of Scripture. God has chosen to reveal himself to humanity through the text of Scripture, having inspired it and directed it to be free from error. God has also acted providentially throughout the course of history to ensure the biblical text is faithfully preserved for future generations. Our belief in the preservation of Scripture is supported by investigation into how the canon of Scripture was formed and how manuscripts were faithfully transmitted throughout the centuries. I will be reading from Isaiah chapter 40, verses 4 through 8. Every valley shall be exalted, and every mountain and hill brought low. The crooked places shall be made straight, and the rough places smooth. The glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all flesh shall see it together. For the mouth of the Lord has spoken. The voice said, "Cry out." And he said, "What shall I cry? All flesh is grass, and all its loveliness is like the flowers of the field. The grass withers, the flower fades, because the breath of the Lord blows upon it. Surely the people are grass. The grass withers, the flower fades, but the word of our God stands forever." Will you approach the Lord of the throne in prayer, please? Dear Heavenly Father, we come to you today thankful and rejoicing for all of our brothers and sisters in Christ that we get to spend time with today, and we thank you for all of the ministers that you have placed in our lives that are teaching us, leading us, and sharing your gospel with us, Lord. God, help us to focus on Christianly things. Help us to focus on what you have created us for. Help us to not be distracted by worldly things. Help us to see all of those around us for who they are, as your creation. Whether or not they have faith in you, Lord, they are still your creation. Help us to see that and treat them as such, and minister to them, share your love, your gospel, plant the seeds, so to speak. Lord, thank you for everything that you've done for us. Thank you for everything you've given to us. Help us to show that to other people and to apply that to our lives and live like that, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
God has given us many promises in the Bible. Amen. Let's all stand and sing about them.
Promises. Today we need to be ever mindful that that as our pastor's away, he's not just on vacation. He's going to leadership conference for our association. So we need to keep him in prayer and all those involved in prayer. Because a lot of times when we get in these large groups, we get focused on numbers. How many people are attending? How many baptisms do we have last year? How many of this? How many of that? Oh, we built this. Oh, we built that. Our one true focus should be, what did you do for the kingdom of God? What can we do to help our fellow churches, to help put another brick in that wall, to help to build that foundation? Just like yesterday, we had VBS. Our, I don't know if you knew this, our youth, they stood up and they stood proud. Our youth were the leaders for these kids. And this is not just me speaking as a dad. This is me talking to you that these are the kids that we watch grow. And they're growing strong, and we should be proud. We should tell them that. We should let them know. But we should also let our fellow brothers and sisters in other churches know that we're there to help, and we're just not here to help us. So we're one family. We're one kingdom working together. I'm going to be reading from Galatians chapter 3, starting with verse 19. Why then the law? It was added because of transgressions, until the offspring should come to whom the promise has been made, and it was put in place through angels by an intermediary. Now an intermediary implies more than one, but God is one. Is the law then contrary to the promises of God? Certainly not. For if a law had been given that could give life, then righteousness would indeed be by the law. But the scripture imprisoned everything under sin, so that the promise by faith in Jesus Christ might be given to those who believe. Now, before faith came, we were held captive under the law, imprisoned until the coming faith would be revealed. So then the law was our guardian until Christ came, in order that we might be justified by faith. But now that faith has come, we are no longer under a guardian. For in Christ Jesus, you are all sons of God through faith. For as many of you as were baptized into Christ have put on Christ. There is neither Jew nor Greek, male and female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. And if you are Christ, then you are Abraham's offspring, heirs according to the promise. Will you join me in prayer? Father God, thank you for helping us to be one. Lord, we pray for those who are not with us, not just our pastor, but we pray for all the leaders, all the other churches. Help them not to be caught up in ego or pride, or help them not to be shamed, because if they are doing your work, then their work is worthy and their work is true and good. And I pray that you help them to take pride in it. And help us to always be mindful that we are not a church alone. We are but a member of many to help build your kingdom. Help us to always be willing, able, and humbly excited to be able to do whatever we can, whenever we can, to build the kingdom, whether it's here or whether it's someone else. Because that one awesome plan is only one that you know. We only know pieces and parts. We pray that you help us to keep that in mind. It's not about us, it's about you and what we can do to glorify you. bring glory to your kingdom, help bring others and let them to know you. Forgive us for our pride and our ego take precedence. It shouldn't be, but it happens, Lord. We're human, and please forgive us. Thank you for being the God that loves us and does forgive us. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Now, being children of God, we can rest assured that God does forgive us. He does love us. He does forgive us. And I don't know about y'all, I screw up a lot. It's hard to keep track just for the day. My thoughts, my ego, my attitude. I think I'm doing good, but am I doing good for me? Or am I doing good for God? But we can take comfort in knowing that God does forgive us. In Ezekiel 36, 25 through 27, we're told, I will sprinkle clean water on you, and you shall be clean from all your uncleanliness and from all your idols. I will cleanse you, and I will give you a new heart, and a new spirit I will put within you. And I will remove the heart of stone from your flesh and give you a heart of flesh. And I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes and be careful to obey my rules. You shall dwell in the land that I gave to your fathers, and you shall be my people, and I will be your God, and I will deliver you from all your uncleanliness, and I will summon the grain and make it abundant and lay no famine upon you. Take comfort in that. He's going to protect us. He's going to forgive us. He's always going to protect us. Thank you.
We do have a task in front of us that is unfinished. May we stand as we sing.
Thank you.
Just a moment, we're going to pray for the Southern Baptist Convention this week and for the messengers that will be attending, that they'll have wisdom. Before we do, I'm going to read first in James chapter 3, starting with verse 13. Who is wise and understanding among you? By his good conduct, let him show his works in the meekness of wisdom. But if you have bitter jealousy and selfish ambition in your hearts, do not boast and be false to the truth. This is not the wisdom that comes down from above, but is earthly, unspiritual, demonic. For where jealousy and selfish ambition exist, there will be disorder and every vile practice. But the wisdom from above is first pure, then peaceable, gentle, open to reason, full of mercy and good fruits, impartial and sincere. And a harvest of righteousness is sown in peace by those who make peace. Now let us go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, first I want to pray for our pastor and for Nora as they travel to the convention. I pray, Lord, for all the messengers. Many are probably right now in airplanes or in airports right now waiting for their flights. We pray, Lord, for safety for them. We pray, Lord, even as they are flying or waiting in airports, that you would give them opportunities to be a witness for you, whether it be by someone that they're sitting beside that might be inquiring and having small talk about where they're headed. But we pray, Father, that you would just guide their conversation even before they get to California. I pray, Father, for a sense of unity among those that will be messengers. I pray, Lord, for wisdom as they consider the annual business of the convention, whether it be in the election of officers, whether it be in resolutions that they vote on, or other business that they deal with. Father, just give them wisdom in doing your will. And Father, I pray, Lord, that when they have times of worship at the convention, you would just bless them and that you would just unify them in such a way that they all just know that they've been in your presence, Father, worshiping together. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
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 I'm going to let you sit for this next song, but may this be our prayer as we sing it together.
Thank you.
of all the Southern Baptist churches through the convention, they're all very different. They're large, small, different worship styles. One thing that we all have in common is a mutually agreed upon faith, and that is that we all ascribe to the Baptist faith and message. I want to be reading, actually leading, not just reading, but leading you all in the cooperation section of that. If you'll check your bulletin there on the bottom of page 3, I guess you'll see where it says Article 14, cooperation. We're going to read that together, and I will lead us. It's sort of like responsive reading, but we're all just going to say it all together for the whole thing, okay? All right, let's join with you, please. Christ's people should, as the occasion requires, organize such associations and conventions as may best secure cooperation for the great objects of the kingdom of God. Such organizations have no authority over one another or over the churches. They are voluntary and advisory bodies designed to elicit, combine, and direct the energies of our people in the most effective manner. Members of New Testament churches should cooperate with one another in carrying forward the missionary, educational, and benevolent ministries for the extension of Christ's kingdom. Christian unity in the New Testament sense is spiritual harmony and voluntary cooperation for common ends by various groups of Christ's people. Cooperation is desirable between the various Christian denominations when the end to be attained is itself justified, and when such cooperation involves no violation of conscience or compromise of loyalty to Christ and His Word as revealed in the New Testament.
Before Dennis comes here, let us all stand one more time and sing the mighty power of God.
Thank you.
hear me?
Yes, sir.
Okay, let me just take a look here. Let me see who I can and can't pick on this morning. It is good to see you. I know I've been away for the last several weeks. Been preaching at New Hope Baptist Church in Newtonville, Indiana. It takes me 1 hour and 5 minutes to get there. And allows me to put some thoughts together. So I've enjoyed that, and I will be there until the end of this month, and then I'll be back to haunt you guys for a little while around here. Today's message is entitled Here, There, and Everywhere. And our focal passages will be in Psalm 139, verses 1 through 12. And I invite you to go ahead and open your Bibles if you would, and just follow along as we go through this. God has given us the Bible for a number of reasons. But one of the main reasons that He gave us the Bible is so we can come to know Him and what kind of God He is. He knows if we do not come to know Him in all of His greatness, we cannot worship Him as we should. We will not serve Him as we should. And we cannot become more like Him as we should. Much of the Bible tells us that He is a God of kindness, love, mercy, patience, holiness, and that He is unchanging. But also the Bible tells us that God is omnipresent. In simple terms, it means God is here, there, and everywhere, all at the same time.
Amen.
Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, Lord, I love You and thank You so much for this opportunity to preach this word, which You've laid on my heart. Now, Lord, guide me as I speak today, and Lord, may it fall upon listening ears. Most of all, Lord, today, if there's someone in our audience that does not know You as their personal Savior, may then today be the day of salvation. Guide us as we worship You, and we ask these things in Your precious and holy name. Amen. Jeremiah 23:24 tells us, can a man hide himself in secret places so that I cannot see him, declares the Lord? Do I not fill heaven and earth, declares the Lord? Reminds me of a story that I heard some time ago where a little boy asked his dad, why is there only one God? And his dad very wisely replied, because God fills all the earth, and there's just no room for any other one. Now, unfortunately, we've seen for some time, that man tries to make a lot of gods. But there is only one true God. And we're going to talk about that one true God and how He is with us at all times. So let's look at the first six verses of our focal passages, starting with verse 1, Psalm 139. I'll be reading out of the English Standard Version. Follow along. I have no idea what page it is in your pew Bible. Sorry, but follow along if you will. O Lord, You have searched me and known me. You know when I sit down and when I rise up. You discern my thoughts from afar. You search out my path and my lying down, and are acquainted with all my ways. Even before a word is on my tongue, behold, O Lord, You know it altogether. You hem me in behind and before, and lay Your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is high. I cannot attain it. Does this sound like someone who doesn't care or who isn't interested in what happens to you? I don't think so. Every day we come into contact with people on our jobs, on the streets, in our neighborhoods, in our schools. And we look at some of these people from time to time and we know their faces and their names. And if someone asked us if we know them, we'd say, yeah, I know them. The fact is, we really don't. All we know about them is their names and their faces. That we are associated with them. When we know someone, we know details about their lives, such as, are they married or single?
what they like and don't like, what kind of car they drive, where they live, if they have children, what their hobbies are, where they go to church, whether or not they're a Christian. These are only some of the details that we know about people that we really know. And as I think about that, I think that God gives us the Bible so we can come to know that He is an omnipresent God. That's why we should take the time on a daily basis to study His Word. Attend churches in a Bible-teaching church like this one right here. You cannot know the God of the Bible unless you spend time in God's Word. Friends, I know many, many folks who like to preach about the Bible, but never read it. And you can tell, if you know and you study the Bible, you can tell it very easily. They don't know what they're talking about. They're preaching something that probably they learned from somebody else. We need to know the Bible. We need to study it. We need to know how to apply it to our lives. And we need to know that God speaks to us through the Bible. You cannot know the God of the Bible unless you spend time in His Word. I believe it's why the devil has gotten Christians so busy. He doesn't want them to have time for the Bible or for church or for prayer. Why? Because the devil knows that God reveals Himself through His Word. The Bible tells us that God is omnipresent. In fact, in Matthew 10:29, we're told that the omnipresent God knows if one little sparrow falls to the ground. This omnipresent God that sees every sparrow that falls to the ground is the same God that watches over us each and every day. I like how the psalmist uses the word him, H-E-M, in verse 5. It contains the idea of guarding a valuable object. God's knowledge and guidance for our protection. So how does God's omnipresence benefit us? Today we'll discuss, I'm just going to discuss three different ways. Starting with, His presence is a comfort to us. His presence is a comfort to us. We can all be thankful that God is omnipresent. Why? If He was not an omnipresent God, it would mean that God couldn't be in this church and in the churches down the street simultaneously. Because God is omnipresent, it means He can be present in all churches or in all places where people worship Him. And at the same time, remember when David wrote, "I will fear no evil, for Thou art with me." He knew that God was with him at all times, and He is with each of us at all times. One of the great things about life is that we have our family and our friends with us to share the good times and the bad times of our lives. Did you know that there are some people in our society that don't have any family or friends? They're really, in essence, all made me think that there are widows and widowers here today in this service whose spouses have been gone for some time and their children are grown up and married with families of their own, and they just kind of feel all alone. Here's the good news. The omnipresent God says to you, says to us, "I will never leave you or forsake you." major problems today is that many people face is the feeling of loneliness. They will tell you that they are surrounded by people, but they feel all alone. If they only knew the God of the Bible, they would know that they are not alone. We all can find great comfort in knowing that God is omnipresent. That is, we really aren't alone. Every day, every minute, we have God with us. Now moving forward, let's look out at verses 7 through 10. Where shall I go from your spirit? Oh, where shall I flee from your presence? If I ascend to heaven, you are there. If I make my bed in Sheol, you are there. If I take the wings of the morning and dwell in the uttermost parts of the sea, even there your hand shall lead me, and your right hand shall hold me. We can rejoice in this life today, knowing that God is omnipresent. David was speaking in hypotheticals here when God, saying that God could be anywhere he chooses. One of the things that will make hell such a horrible place is that the sinner will be forsaken by God, or better translated, eternally separated. There is no goodness in hell. No matter how our TV shows and how people make fun of hell, try to lighten it up, there is nothing good about it. There's not going to be one great grand party going on. But the worst thing is that God's presence will not be there. See, friend, even the sinner enjoys God's presence on this earth. They may not know it. Then hell won't be there. That is enough right now for us to think of our lost friends and family who have never made a commitment. Why in the world don't we say something? Well, that's a sermon for another day, and I know Steve's talked about that many times. Why? Why? Think about this for a moment. On the cross, the Lord paid the price for our sins. And on the cross, he suffered thirst as no one has ever thirsted, so we could never have to thirst like the rich man who cried out for one drop of water to cool his tongue as he suffered in hell. Remember, on the cross, Jesus cried out, "I thirst." He also suffered loneliness. Always during his life on earth, he referred to God as his heavenly Father. But when he took on our sins, on himself, the Father-Son relationship was severed. He became a sinner before the holy God of heaven, who cannot associate with evil, with sin. Jesus then cried out, my God, why have you forsaken me?" Lost person, you may not think it important now, but one of the most horrible things, as I said before about hell, is that you will never again have access to God. Friend, I don't know, it's been a long time since I was a member of this church. And a lot of faces have changed. I look over this congregation, I said this the last time that I preached a few months ago here, and where I used to see certain faces in certain areas, I don't see those anymore. I see new faces, that's a great thing. Some of you aren't as pretty as others. I'm sorry, Danny, I had to do that. I promise I wouldn't pick on Susan today, so I'm not going to do that. But I don't know everybody in this congregation. I don't know your personal testimonies. I haven't heard them. I don't know who in this room is saved and who isn't. Oh, I know some. Because I remember seeing you walk down the aisle, or I have heard your testimonies, but I don't know about half of you. I don't know if you're saved or not. Friends, today can be, should be, would be the day of salvation if you just come forward at the end of this sermon. I can remember D.L. Moody talking about it wasn't D.L. Moody who said this, but he was talking about it. The pastor at the time, that Moody was, he used to say at the end of a sermon, you think about it and get back, I'm paraphrasing this, and get back with me. And then that night was the great Chicago fire. Many of the people that were in attendance that night perished in that fire. And he said from then on, never again will I say, end of service, to say, you think about it and come back. Because we never know when today may be our last day on earth. So if you've never received Christ as your personal Savior, I trust, I pray that today you come forward. Talk to me, talk to Brother JD, talk to your Sunday school teacher, talk to somebody about receiving Christ as your personal Savior, because God wants to be the omnipresent God in your life. What a comfort it is to know that God is with us every day of our life. His presence is a comfort to us. Also, His presence is a challenge to us. Knowing God is with us every day not only comforts us, but it also challenges us. We should be challenged when we realize that our omnipresent God is with us every day. When we come to know He is the kind of God we want to make, when we come to know that He is that kind of God, we want to make Him proud. Every good coach realizes and encourages his players to invite their parents to come watch them play. Why? Because every good coach knows that nothing inspires a child to be his best, like looking on the sidelines and seeing his parents encouraging him. Have you ever had someone come and evaluate you? I have. Guess Rick has too. I can remember on one job that I had, we had an evaluator come in. That guy followed me around for 2 days with a clipboard in his hand. Wouldn't talk to me. I mean, not much. You know me, I like to talk to folks. He wouldn't talk to me. And he would keep marking these things down. And I thought, man, I must be in big trouble. No, he was just going through doing an evaluation. Or I can remember when I was in the Air Force, and it'd come time to have our evaluations done so we could maybe get promoted and stuff, and people would be watching. Do you realize God is evaluating us each and every day? Oh, maybe not in such a critical way, but evaluating us, watching us. When Christians come to realize that God is omnipresent, they recognize that they cannot hide behind the excuses. God is with us 24 hours a day. His presence is a comfort to us, and His presence is a challenge to us. We should want to do our absolute very best for God. But what is it that we give God? Now, if you would have been in Newtonville with me last week, I preached a whole message on that. Why is it that we give God the leftovers? Okay, I'm not going to get into that sermon because you don't want to be here that long. And I really don't either. I'm coming home. So the third point. His presence is a caution does. Dr. John Brell made it a practice to open his course on the doctrine of God at Edinburgh University with these words, "Gentlemen," I guess there were no ladies in the audience, "Gentlemen, we must remember when discussing God, we cannot talk about him without his hearing every word we say. We may be able to talk to our fellows, as it were, behind their backs, but God is everywhere, yes, even in this classroom. Therefore, in all of our discussions, we must be aware of his infinite presence and talk about him, as it were, before his face." I have to wonder, friends, would we say near as much about somebody else if we knew they were standing right beside us? I know that's no fun. But sometimes we get caught up in talking about somebody else, mainly because we know they're not there. But you know why? When we're busy hacking somebody down, God is. God's there. Christian, if you're into that kind of stuff, shame on you. God knows. God knows. While we recognize that God's presence brings comfort to us, and it's a challenge to us, we also need to recognize God's presence is also a caution to us. Every day, God sees the good and the bad that we do. Students, well, we've got some students in attendance today. The next time you're taking a test and the teacher has his or back turned, the devil tempts you to cheat, remember that the teacher may not be able to see you, but God does. Now, I don't know, maybe kids don't cheat anymore. I did. How do you think I made it through school? You laugh, but that's kind of true. I was just thinking, you know, generally when I use illustrations in a sermon, I think of all the stupid things that I did. And that was one of them. Students, God sees you, whatever you're doing. Whenever you're a Christian, if you're a Christian, do your absolute best, relying on God to be a good witness to the others.
Amen.
Do your best. Young person, yeah, we got some young people in here. The next time you're away and home on a date or maybe just hanging out with your friends, remember that your parents may not be with you, may not see you, but God does. Oh, how I messed that one up so many times. Sometimes just because I thought I was in church camp. I can get away with stuff. No, you can't. That's the worst place to get in trouble. First warrior. Then I won't get into that. Thank you. Don't ask me. Husband, wife, next time you sit down and watch those shows trending on many of the services, you would be ashamed to have anyone know you watch. Remember, God knows what you're watching. And I added this, probably your kids do too. Be careful. Just because you're in your own house doesn't mean that God doesn't know. Let's look at the last two verses of the quote passages, verses 11 and 12. If I say, surely the darkness shall come, shall cover me, and the light about me by... Let's start that one again. If I say, surely the darkness shall cover me, and the light about me be night, Even the darkness is not dark to you. The night is bright as day, as the day, for the darkness is as light with you. David knew that it doesn't matter if we sin in a pitch dark place or in broad daylight. God is where we are and can see as good in the dark as in the daylight. I grew up in a house, my mom used to say all the time, nothing good ever happens after midnight. And you know what, if you watch the news, most bad things do happen after midnight. And I really believe it's because people think, well, it's so late, who's going to know? Well, number one, God knows. But as the older I get, the more I come to realize, stay away. Stay away from it. Christian, if you're out that late and you're not doing work or whatever, you probably shouldn't be out. It's going to leave trouble. Always does. A burglar. I like this. I always got to have something funny. A burglar broke into a house one night and shone his flashlight around looking for valuables. And when he picked up a CD player to place in his sack, a strange disembodied voice echoed from the dark saying, Jesus is watching you. He literally jumped out of his skin, clicked off his flashlight, and froze. When he heard nothing more after a bit, he shook his head, promised himself a vacation after his next big score, then clicked the light back on and began searching for more valuables. Just as he pulled the stereo out of the house so he could disconnect the wires, clear as a bell, he heard, Jesus is watching you. Totally rattled, he shone the light around frantically looking for the source of the voice. Finally, in the corner of the room, his flashlight beam came to rest on a barrel. Did you say that? He hissed at the parrot. Yes, the parrot confessed, then squawked. I'm just trying to warn you. The burglar relaxed. Warn me, huh? You do. Who do you think you are anyway? Moses, replied the bird. Moses, the burglar laughed. What kind of stupid people would name a parrot Moses? The bird promptly answered, the same kind of people that would name a Rottweiler Jesus. Yep, Jesus, God, is always watching. Now we've seen today that God is everywhere, sees everything, and nothing ever escapes his knowledge. God fills the heavens and the earth, and yet he is small enough to live within our hearts. God is omnipresent. So before we close the message, I just want people in this room to think about whether or not they've ever asked Jesus Christ to come into their lives, to save them from their sins, to accept him as Lord and Savior of their lives. Friends, there is no way to heaven other than Jesus Christ, and asking him to save you your sins. So before we sing our invitation song, I want to lead you in a prayer. I just want to pray. But at this particular time, folks, there is no special incantation that you have to say to ask Jesus Christ in your life. It is really just as simple as, Lord, please forgive me of my sins. I accept you as my personal Savior. I understand that you are Lord of my life, Lord of this world. It's really all you have to say. Now, some of you that may not be Christians, you say, yeah, but I got to go forward. I got to go in front of all these people. Okay, friends, I made that decision when I was 8 years old. found the Bible, Brother J.D., and I told you wrong. I said I was 9. I was 8 years old. I found the Bible with the date in. It was in August of 1990. And anyway, I accepted the Lord right in the other building. Actually, I did it at my house. But I'm going to tell you, folks who may be just a little bit nervous about coming forward, number one, if you wave at me, I'll come and get you. I've done that many times. I'll walk with you down the aisle. But also, don't be scared, because everyone in this room who is Christian is going to be praying for you. Because they've all done it. Or maybe you've never followed the Lord in baptism. I can remember when I was in the Air Force at the time. Or maybe at another church, I don't remember. But a lady that I knew I knew her all my life. I grew up with her kids. Right here in this church. And she realized that she had never been saved. And came forward. Well, he did all kinds of things in this church. We just figured, yeah. But she understood. Friends, it's never too late. Maybe there was a day that you came forward and took the pastor's hand. Maybe you got wet in the dunking booth up there. But you just never, okay, in the baptistry. But you came to realize, you know what? I never really gave my heart and life over to Jesus Christ. I've been fooling everybody. Today is the day of salvation. Or maybe you just want to join a Bible-believing church. I still believe I hold the record in joining this church. It's been 4 times now. And if the Lord has His way, maybe I'll go to another one and come back to one of them. And that's not too many years away. But I encourage you to do that. Don't be scared. Put all that aside. Let's go, Lord, prepare in prayers. We prepare ourselves for our invitation. Heavenly Father, Lord, I love you and thank you so much for this time that we've had together. Lord, I just thank you so much for the opportunity to preach this word. Now, Lord, again, I just implore that person that may be in our audience today that does not know you as their personal Savior, may today be the day of salvation. Or maybe that person that just wants to follow you in baptism. Or maybe the person that wants to join a Bible-believing church. May your Holy Spirit just be on them. Guide us in this time of invitation, I pray. Amen. Stand with me as we sing together. This is my Father. Thank you.
right now, I'm going to ask Dennis if he would go back to the back, and also Rick Simpson and Jerry Brooke, if you two would join Dennis back at the back so that we can greet you as we leave today. It has been good to be in the house of the Lord today. Amen?
Amen.
Join us tonight at 6 o'clock as we hear about some really bad hermeneutics, and also next Sunday morning, Brother Steve is going to start a new sermon series, starting in the book of, it'll be in the book of Judges. So if you want to be on the ground floor of that, I encourage you, please come next Sunday morning as we get started in the book of Judges. And we'll see how long that's going to go. Anyway, we'll enjoy that. Let's close out now in a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, I thank you so much, Father, that you are in Ukraine, comforting the Ukrainians, that you are in California, that you are at St. Vincent Hospital right now, comforting Beulah Brown, that you are comforting Steve Wicker right now where he is, that you are right here amongst us, that you are with us as we go to our homes today, and that you will be with us tomorrow as we go to our jobs. Thank you so much for that. Father, I pray that you just use this sermon, that it would serve as a challenge and a caution to us this week as we remember that we are living for you this week, knowing that you are with us every day, knowing that you see what we do and you hear what we say every day. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.